UK Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
It is Bitwise Zor. So, can someone wants to explain it in the next class? I'll give 5 minutes for them. Can someone take the responsibility and just explain what is Zor operator? Who wants to take? I'll give 5 minutes. So I not only teach the topics here, I'll also make you to get the confidence. So I'll ask a weekly one person to explain some topic for 5 minutes. So who will explain for this week? I want someone to explain Bitwise Zor, exclusive Or. So who wants to take this up? In the next class, they should explain this. Okay. So Sandhya wants to take this up. So in the next class, for 5 minutes, Sandhya will explain us what is Bitwise Zor. So I'm not explaining now. Thank you, Sandhya. So you can practice, and then I'll make you as presenter in the next class. You can explain to others. Thank you. Okay. So now we'll discuss on shift operator. So till now we discussed on arithmetic operators, relational operators, logical operators. We also discussed on bitwise operators. Now we are going to discuss on shift operators. So this is very simple. See, now I have written. Let me explain this. So I have written 6 less than 2. So this is 2 times less than, we call it as left shift operator. So the first number you have to convert to binary. So in shift operators, the first one you need to convert to binary. So which is 110. The left shift 2 means you have to move this to left side. So this is left side and this is right side. So left shift indicates you have to move this to 2 times left side and add zeros there. Okay. So and then you need to convert the total value to decimal. Very simple. Convert the first number to binary, and left shift 2 indicates move this to 2 times that side and add 2 zeros. Or blindly you can put 2 zeros. For example, if I ask you 5 left shift 3, so the answer is for 5 it is 101, and left shift 3 means you have to add 3 zeros and you have to convert this to decimal. So 2 power 0, 2 power 1, 2 square, 2 cube is 8, plus 2 power 4, 2 power 5. 2 power 5 is 32. So the answer is 40. So very simple, 5 left shift 3 is 40. So let's try to verify that. 5 left shift 3. Let me go here. 5 left shift 3. I should get 40 now. Let's see whether I'm correct or not. So I'm compiling it. I'm executing it now. See the answer. So you can see here that the answer is 40. Okay. So that is about left shift operators. You just need to convert to binary and add zeros. And right shift operator is something like you just need to remove the right side values. For example, right shift 6 right shift 2 means you need to convert to binary and remove whatever is mentioned in the right shift. So two digits you have to remove, and remaining one you have to convert to decimal. For example, let me try to convert 16 or 17 to, okay, let me try to explain this value. So 17 right shift 3. So let me explain this. So for 17, what do I need to do here? So I need to write 17 here. I need to write 2. 2 8s are 16. Reminder is 1. 2 4s are 8. Reminder is 0. 2 2s are 4. Reminder is 0. and two ones to remainder zero. So I need to write like this. So I need to write 1001 for 17. 1001. So right shift 3 indicates I have to remove the right side 3 values. So let me remove them, and the answer is 1010. If I convert to decimal, the answer is 240 and 241. So the answer is 2. So 17 right shift 3, the answer is 2. So let me try to do that. I'll go to my program. 17 right shift 3. Is that the question? Yeah, 17 right shift 3. So the answer is 2. So let me save it. Go to the command prompt and then compile again. And then execute it. So the answer which I'm getting here is, answer which I'm getting here is 2. That is the answer which we got. So is it clear about left shift and right shift operator? Is it clear about shift operators? Ping me if it's clear. Okay. I see only a couple of responses. I'm not seeing the response from Jesse and Parimala. Okay, so okay, that's fine. Okay, so this is about shift operators. So let me ask one question and I'll see who will respond first. So Windows R Notepad. So yeah, how it become 10 becomes 2 is, how are you getting, how come 10 becomes 2 is, good question. So I just need to convert, so this is binary, I want to convert this to decimal. So if I want to convert this to decimal, I guess you missed my first class, so I need to write like this, 0 into 2 power 1, and then 0 into 2 power 0, 1 into 2 power 1. For example, if I want to convert 1001 into decimal, I have to write 1 into 2 power 0 and plus 0 into 2 power 1, and I need to write 0 into 2 square, and then here I need to write 1 into 2 cube, and then this is 8 plus, this is anyway 0, this is 0, this is 1, so 8 plus 1 which is 9, like this. Yeah, okay. So now let me ask a question, and I want to see who will tell me first. Okay, so Windows R Notepad. So what is the answer for 3 left shift 1? Not seeing any response still. It's very simple. 3 less than 1. So you just need to. I got one response from Bhavik saying it's 12. Jesse, I got response 7. Padmini, I got response 6. I got all mixed responses. So let me explain this. So for 3, the binary value is. What is the binary value of 3? It is 101. So 101, 2 power 0, is it 101? No, not 101. For 3, the answer 011, I guess. Yeah, it is 11. For 3, it is 11. And left shift 1 is very simple. I need to add a 0 left side. I need to move this left side. I need to add a 0 here. So now I need to convert this to decimal. So 2 power 0, 2 power 1, 2 square. So the answer is 6. Yeah, the answer is 6. I see mixed responses. So just blindly, when you see left shift 1 or left shift 3, just blindly add 3 zeros at the right side. Like this you need to work. So let me ask next question. So until all of you respond to me correctly, I'll continue this. So what is the answer for 6 left shift 2? Oh no, I have it on the screen. So I got one response from Sandhya, it's 24. Okay, let's verify from others. I want to see the response from Jesse. Perfect. Thank you for answering. So if you see here, let me put, okay. So I'll just explain it. So for 6, I need to write like this. 2 threes are, remainder is 0. And 2 ones, remainder is 1. 1 1 0. 1 1 0. And again, I need to add 2 zeros. So 2 power 0, 2 power 1, 2 square, 2 cube is 8. 2 power 4 is 16. So 16 plus 8. You don't need to write all this also. Blindly, you can calculate. So here, 16 plus 8, which is 24. Okay, great. So now, question to all of you again. What is the answer for 3 right shift 4? This one, let me see who will answer. If you answer, okay, instant reply I got from Mauna. Yeah, you're right. So any other answers? Yeah. So right shift means I have to remove the values. So now if I write for 3, the value is 0 1 1, and I have to remove 4 from this, means all are gone, all will be gone. So the answer is 0. So if someone asks you, for example, in the exam, if you see question like this, 19 right shift 20, you don't need to put your paper and pen. You can blindly tell the answer is 0, because right 20 bits should go, and definitely 19 will not have 20 bits. 19 will maximum have around 5 to 6, because when you write like this, 19, when you convert to binary, you will only get so let me see, I don't want to calculator, and I'll go to binary decimal. If I put 19 and click on binary, I have only 10011. So 10011 is for 19, and I have to remove 20 bits from this. I only have 5 bits here. So even, can you tell me what is the answer for this one? What is the answer for this one? Yeah, it is 0. So now, what is the answer for this one? 19 right shift 3, what is the answer? I want to see for response from all of you. 19 right shift 3. Yeah, I saw the response from Mona. Okay, yeah, Parimala, I'm getting response now. Thank you for answering. So Bobby, I think you have to correct it. So 19 right shift 3 indicates you have to remove this 3. Just remove this 3 and convert this to decimal. So again, 10 to decimal is 2. Yeah, you're right now. Okay. So just answer me if you are clear with the shift operators. We will move to the very important operators for today, which is unary operators. So is it clear now, shift operators? Just reply clear if you are okay, or else I can explain again. Okay, so thank you very much. Okay, so now, so just quickly I'll revise. So we discussed on arithmetic operators, we discussed on relational operators, we also discussed logical operators. We discussed on bitwise operators, for which XOR operator Sandhya is going to explain next class for 5 minutes. And shift operators, right shift and left shift. The last one which we have for today is unary operators. Okay, so unary operators is the one which is primarily focused in the exams or whatever, so whatever we go. Okay, so now let me explain one by one. So I have here printf, don't mind, it should be here console.writeline. So what I'll do here, okay, let's, for now I leave it to printf. So you have to think that I'm just printing the value of I. Okay, so now can you guys tell me what is the output for the first box? Okay, so I'll just tell you one thing, I plus plus blindly increments the value of I. So I plus plus is something like I plus 1. So I plus plus, so initially I started I value as 10, and I plus plus, now the value will become 11. So here the value is 11. So for this one, for this box, the value is 11. So now plus plus I is also same, but this is called post increment, and this is called pre-increment. So, but since no other operators are involved here, so the answer here is 11, and the answer for this I is equal to 10 plus plus I, here also the answer is 11. No, here also the answer is 11. Plus plus I, that is you are incrementing the value of I, so the answer is 11 here. So I'll come back to this again later. Keep this aside for now, keep this aside. So I'll give a star mark here. Now we'll focus on this one. These are important. So I have two variables here. So now let me zoom this one and try to understand this better. Okay, so here I'm writing int I j, and I'm writing I is equal to 10, j is equal to I plus plus. So here what happens, this is called post increment. So this is called post increment. So first the value of I is assigned to j. After assigning the value of I to j, the value of I will be incremented because of I gave I plus plus. So first whatever value is there for I, that is assigned to j, and I value will get incremented. So I value here is 11, j value which is assigned before incrementing is 10. Okay, so let's try to verify this. Let me write a program and then we'll try to confirm that. So I'll go to operators LAN. I'll write here int I is equal to 10, int j or whatever, let me give simple i comma j, and here I'm writing i is equal to 10, I'm writing j is equal to I plus plus, and then I'm writing here console.writeLine I, and then I'm copying this, pasting it here. I want to print the value of j. Okay, so I repeat here, this is called post increment. So what happens here is first the value of I will be assigned to j. First the value of I, whatever is there first, 10 is there, so I value of I is assigned to j, then I value gets incremented. That's why this is called post increment. So first assigned, then increment, post increment. So value of i here is 11 because its value is incremented, and value of j here is first assigned, so the value of j here is 10. Okay, so let me compile it and execute it. So file, save, go to the command prompt, CSE dot, and then execute it. So I can see that the answer is 11 and 10, which we got here, 11 and 10. So this is about post increment. So we have something called pre increment here. So we have here, which is pre-increment. So here what happens is, first the value of I gets incremented and then it is assigned to j. So can you guess what is the answer here? Sorry. So can you guess what is the answer for this one? So I repeat again here, this is called pre-increment. So first I value will get incremented, then it will be assigned to j. So I am seeing some responses. So what is the value of first the value of I initially I value is 10. So this is called pre-increment. So first the value of I will get incremented and then it is assigned to j. So I value is 10, when it gets incremented, I value becomes 11, so and then it is assigned to j. So the answer here is I is 11 and j is 11. Okay, so I saw mixed responses from some of you, like 10, 11. Okay, so now let's try to understand. So I'll not explain this, but let's see who will explain correct. So this one, can you guess the answer? This is post decrement. Let's see who will answer correctly. What is the value of I and what is the value of j? getting 9-10 or 10-9? What is the answer? 10-9 or 9-10? First I am printing I value. Remember, first I am printing I value. I am printing I value first. Okay. So here, let me explain this. So first, I value whatever is there is assigned to J. I value whatever is there is assigned to J. Then I value is getting reduced. I value is getting reduced. So I value is 9 and J value is 10. So I saw most of you are I value is 9, J value is 10, I value is 9. So Bhavik, yeah, now you are correct. So Bhavik corrected. So I value is 9. So Jesse, is it clear now for you? Yeah. So I just repeat for the sake of others. So here I'm just printing first the value of I and then I'm printing the value of J. So here I have I is equal to 10 and then I have J is equal to I minus minus. That means I'm first assigning the value of I to J and then I'm decrementing. So this is called post decrement. First assignment happens and then decrement happens. So since I value 10 is assigned to J, the value of J is 10 and then I value is getting decremented. So the value becomes 9. So I is 9, J is 10. Okay. I'm not going to explain this. Let me see who will explain. Who will tell me this correctly? Who will answer correctly? Can all of you answer this? Got one quick response from Padmini. Yeah, you're right. Thank you. So Mauna, you're right. I'm waiting for others. What could be the answer for this? Yeah, Sandhya, you're right. I'm expecting a response from Parimala, Bobby, Jesse. Okay, so here I'll explain this. So here this is called pre-decrement. So something similar to this. In this case, what is the answer we got? So in this case, what is the answer we got? All of you, we got in this case, whatever I rounded now, previously we saw some time back, pre-increment, we got the 11. So here, similarly, that is similar. This is also similar to this, but this is pre-decrement. So first I value will get reduced, then it is assigned to J. I value will get reduced, then it is assigned to J. So what could be the answer here? No, Sonal, it is not 9 and 10. So let me explain again. So here, whatever I we have 10, so first I value will go down, will get reduced. I value will get reduced because minus minus I. So that means I value will become 9. Once I value becomes 9, that is getting assigned to J. This I minus minus is different from minus minus I. When you put I minus minus, first it will be assigned, then this will be decremented. But minus minus I, first it will be decremented, then it will be assigned. So here, in this case, I value is assigned to J first, that's why here you are getting 10 and then decremented, here you are getting 9. But here it doesn't happen like this. Here, first I value will goes down, I value will be reduced, so I value will become 9, then it is assigned to J. So here it is 9 and 9, both are 9. So Jesse, is it clear for you now? So feel free, if you are not able to understand, I will take some more examples. Okay, so the blind thing which you can keep in mind is, for pre-increment or pre-decrement, both the values will be same. Okay, so let me ask three questions I will ask. So let me see who will tell correctly. Okay, so now I have here I is equal to 7 I plus plus. So what is the answer now? What is the value of I and what is the value of J? Okay, remember I'm printing I value first. you write the answer like this. You don't need to write. You write the answer like this. I is equal to comma j is equal to, like that you write. So okay, so I see, did I get the response from, yeah, I'm waiting for the response from Jesse and yeah, okay. So here what happens here is the value of I is 7, so this is called post increment. So in this case what happens is first the value of I is assigned to j. So here first the value of I is assigned to j, so j value will be 7, and then I value gets incremented, I value becomes 8, so the answer is 8, 7. See, very blindly you can remember. For example, if you are putting p is equal to q plus plus, so in this case for example you are putting q is equal to 9, so in this case first the value of q is assigned to p, so p will become 9, and then q plus plus means q value will get incremented, so that value becomes 10. So remember, this is very simple, very very simple, but only thing is you should not have any confusion here. So let me change this font. Okay, let me ask one more question here. So what is the answer for minus minus I? Let me see who will answer correctly. Yeah, so ping me the answer. Minus minus I, j is equal to minus minus I. So one blind thing you should remember, when it is pre-increment or pre-decrement, both the answers will be same. So here minus minus I, that means I value will be decremented and then assigned to j. So I value will be decremented here and then assigned to j. So both answers are 6. Okay, so let me answer this way. So what is the answer for this one? Can you ping the answer now? Yeah, Mona, you're right. Sarika, you're right. Padmini, you're right. Babik, you're right. I am not saying the response. Bobby, you're right. So I wanted to see the response from I want to see the response from a couple of you. So please okay, so Parimala, you're right. No, it is not 6-6 again. Okay, so I'll explain it again. So here what happens here is first when it is I minus minus, first the value of I is assigned to j, then the value of I will get decremented. So first the value of I is assigned to j, so j value will be 7 and I value gets decremented, so I value is 6. Yeah, you're right, Parmila. Okay, so any doubts in this pre-increment, post-increment, pre-decrement and post-increment? So is it clear now? Reply if it's clear, or else I'll give some more examples. Please be frank, reply if it is clear, otherwise I'll give some more examples. Okay, so we are done with operators. The important part is this one, so I'll be sending assignment with some of the questions in this section. So please answer that, please send the assignments for me, and in case if you have not received the previous assignments, just drop a mail to my email ID. I'll be adding you in the mail thread, so I'll ping you. If you have not received the previous assignments, just drop a mail to me. I'll include this document. I'll not be sending. This is some material I will send, but this is my own copyrighted, so I'll not be sharing this document. But I'll send some other documents which are useful for you. Okay. I'm sorry. Okay, so So now, in case if you're not received the assignment, I mean, in the previous assignments, just drop a mail to me. My email ID, I'm pinging meghnadh.h2kinfosys@gmail.com. So drop a mail to me, meghnadh.h2kinfosys@gmail.com. So just mention in the subject, mention as .NET, and mention that you have not received the previous assignments. So I'll definitely send you the assignments from. So the only expectation from you is answer in the class, just to make it interactive, and also please send the assignments so that I feel like you are working, you're practicing, so that end of the course it is, you are paying the money, so you have to learn it. So and as I'm getting money, I have to do justice for it. So please practice, please ensure that we are using the best possible extent the course. And if you're happy with the course, just refer your friends, so that that will benefit them as well as us. So, and if you have any suggestions, feel free to drop an email to meghnadh.h2kinfosys. I'll definitely try to plan them in the next class. So if you're not getting some topics, or if I'm going a bit faster, please drop a mail to my email ID. I'll just if you don't want to discuss here, I'll just definitely consider that. Okay, so shall we continue or we'll take 5 minutes logical break, and then we'll continue again, or we'll stop here. Okay, so I got one response to continue. What about others? Bobby, yeah, feel free. I mean, Jesse, I think Jesse got bored. Both are fine for you. Okay, so as we are democratic, and I got a response to continue, so I don't want to continue for a longer time. I'll take only 15 more minutes, then I'll stop. Okay, so this is so Jesse, is it fine? We'll just continue for 15 minutes and then we'll stop. Okay, so we just done with operators, and we just done with data types. We also saw the structure of C# program. So now we are going to discuss on just a minute. I'll just save it. Okay, so we'll discuss on control structures which we have. So I'll just open the PPT which I have prepared. So I also used to take classes on C programming. So that is the PPTs which I have prepared. A lot of PPTs, I spend a lot of time, that's the reason I'm not. So we have control structures, if condition, okay, we have if condition, conditional operators like that. So let me open this. Okay, I'm just deleting this. Okay, so this material, okay, so now we'll discuss on if condition and then we'll stop. Okay, so again, as I said before, you will see only so control structures. We have two types of control structures. One is branching and the other one is looping. So for branching is something like, we'll check for a condition, and if the condition is true, execute some code. If the condition is false, execute some other code. So that is what we call it as branching. So if condition, if else, if else, or switch case, or conditional operator. So these comes under branching. And looping is somewhere where you want to repeat the task, you want to repeat similar task, then we go for looping. For example, if I want to print hello 5 times, I'll just use for loop, and inside that I'll write hello. So instead of writing console.writeline hello 5 times, I'll use a for loop, and I'll write only console.writeline once. So flow control structures are two types. One is branching and the other one is looping. So now we'll just see what is an if condition. Now we already saw if condition. I just wanted to add some more to that, and then we'll stop for today. So start, I'll read the inputs, and if condition is true, the statements inside true will be executed, and if the condition is false, the statement inside the false will be executed, and then stop. So for example, if I want to check whether the entered number is even or odd, read the value of n, and n modulo 2 equal to 0. If it is true, even number. if it is false, odd number, and stop. So this is the program which we saw, and this is the program. So for if condition, as I told already, you have to use double equal to. Inside if condition, you have to use double equal to. So here I'm writing printf enter number. So anyway, this is for C language. Okay, so for C sharp, we'll be writing console.writeline. Okay, so I think I'll explain this again. I'll stop here. So we have 5 minutes. So I thought of continuing, but yeah. So tomorrow we'll start freshly on what are control structures, what are conditional operators, switch case, and we have for loop, while loop, do while loop. So we'll discuss all these things in the next class. So we have control structures. I think 1 hour is not sufficient for that. I think, yeah. Okay. So far we are good. So only other than this, why do we need Visual Studio? We have covered. So we have covered 1 hour 45 minutes, and this is 1 hour, so 2 hour 45 minutes, and we have covered 3 hour 45 minutes. We also saw ORI of Dot and Framework. So okay, we are going good. I think we need to go bit. Okay. So any questions you have, feel free to ask now. We have 5 minutes, so if you have any questions, feel free to ask me. So Jesse, do you have any questions to me, Jesse? Or yeah, we will be working on a project. We'll be working on a project at the end of the course. I'll give the requirements. You have to practice on it, and every day I'll be checking the status. I'll ask you to design a website with some 5-6 pages. And you have to work on it, and every day randomly I'll select a couple of you and then ask you to share the screen and show me what is the progress. Definitely by the end of so here the course duration is 49 hours, so it might just go around 50 to 52 hours, but yeah we will, it'll take around 49 to 50 hours. Is Sanjay, is that your question? How much time it'll take? Is that your question? So every day we are taking for 1.5 hour. Yeah, that is .NET. Yeah. So yeah, .NET is very vast syllabus, so we'll be covering the key concepts which are useful. So if you see, like, we have around like 100 hours, 120 hours as well, but we have selected the important topics. Yeah, mostly we are covering all the topics.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I'm asking, like, you know, just to complete C sharp alone, not the entire document package.
Okay. Only C sharp. Okay. C sharp alone, it is like 9 hours for C sharp programming, and we have OOPS concepts in C sharp. So total 15 hours. Like we have inheritance, interfaces, like this, we have so many concepts. So total it'll take around 15 hours. So we are done with 4.5 hours. So we'll have 10-11 hours more. Yeah. Yeah. So VB we are not going to learn, because as most of the projects currently in the market are using C sharp. So initially it was there as a part of this course, but since we are not getting much requirements from VB, so we are just focusing more on C sharp. But other concepts are same, except VB. Other concepts are same between VB.NET and C#.NET. So if you see here, all the concepts which we have included in .NET, they are same for C sharp and VB.NET. Like this, the concepts which are mentioned here, ADO.NET, ASP.NET, all these are same for VB.NET and C#.NET. Okay, so any other questions? Yeah, VB we are not included in this course, yes. Otherwise the course will go to 70-80 hours, which will be beyond the planned schedule. Any other questions you have? I'll send this PDF for all of you. I think I have sent to all of you. Yeah, if you want that, maybe you have to talk to H2K team. Just to asking to include that, because most of the students which we are getting response from H2K, so they wanted to learn C#. Even in real time as I'm working, so I saw that most of the companies are using C#.net instead of VB.net. So just a second.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.